To continue on what we did last time, let's try an example that starts from the network graph. So typically this is a network graph. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 nodes. And we have here node A, B, C, D, and E, right? And the connectivity, let's assume we have this connectivity, for example. And let's assume we also have this one, okay? So this is what we have as a network graph. Typically, the representation of the network in terms of nodes and the lengths connecting them is called a network graph. And in the graph theory, the classical graph theory, they use the term edge to describe the link, right, that connects any two nodes, okay? Instead of calling it a link, they call it an edge, okay? And then we have the nodes, okay? That's in a classical graph theory representation. So what we are looking for here is, let's assume now we have the values of the probability of blocking. So point, for example, 0 to 5, 0.05, 0.02, 0.01, 0.05 as well, 0.025 and 0.01, for example. Okay? So these are the different links and the probability of blocking at these links. And assume that we are looking for the overall, so the question says find or deduce the probability of blocking, right, between A and D. Okay. So I want the probability of blocking between the nodes A and D, right? Assuming that I have this graph. Let me see. Okay. So now, what do we need to do as a first step? Find all the different paths or routes from A and D, and then try to put them in kind of an extended fashion, right? So, and let me just add one more here. I like to do it this way, just to unify things, okay? So assume that I'm looking for all the paths. So this is one of my first paths, right? A, E, D, right? Another path that we can find quickly, for example, is A, B, C, D, right? Okay, and so on. So you'll keep on getting those. As you get each one of those, you will basically put it here. So A and D is the other end, right? And the first path that I found goes through E, and then it reaches D, right? And for that one, the values are 0.025 and 0.01, right? What's the other path that we just showed on the picture? It's A, B, C, and then D, right? So that one goes through node B, right? And then node C, and then D, right? And the values are 0.025. From B to C, it's 0.05. And from C to D, it's 0.025. What else?
ACD.
There is one ACD, right? So CD is already existing. All I need to add is A to C, right? And the value for that one is 0.05 as well, okay? What else?
ABED.
So AB and then going to E, right? Okay, so A, B, E, D, sorry?
A, B, D.
Yeah, A, B, E takes you how much? So B, E was
0.02.
Okay, what else?
A, B, D.
A, B, D. Yeah, so this one. Correct? And this one has a value equal to 0.01, right? What else?
So even like if the path is very long, is it considered?
Doesn't matter if it's very long. What's important is that it adds new links. If it goes through existing links, you don't need to consider it because it's already considered in the calculations, right? So what other paths you can think of? So do we have a connection from C to E? No. Do we have a connection from C to D? Yes, and it's considered. So I think we are done, right? From B going to D, you can go through C, you can go through E. So through C and through E. They are both there, right? So we are done, right? Any other paths? No. Okay. Okay. So now the question is how to get the total probability of blocking in this case. So let me actually do something because this is the most complicated case. Let me just cancel one of these to make life easier so that we can see what we are doing. So I want to remove actually the AC part. I want to remove this, right? Which means I'm removing this. Now the network is a little bit more tractable, but still not trivial. Okay. So this one and this one. Okay. Correct? Okay. Now the question is if I want to reduce this such that I get the overall blocking probability, what can I do?
AC and CD.
Yeah, so basically AC and A what?
BC and CD
in series, yes. So basically you can think of this similar exactly to what you do in a connection of resistors, right? And then you reduce them using series and parallel connection until you get an equivalent resistance between two nodes, right? In this case, you are getting an equivalent probability of blocking between two nodes, which are A and D. Now, similar to what happens in resistance, to know whether a connection is series or parallel, you just check how the current behaves at that connection, right? If the current divides, then this is a parallel connection. If the current, the same current going through one connection is the same that goes through the second one, then this is a series connection. Here, it's the flow of data, right? So connectivity, when it comes to point B, to point B, and it wants to go to point B, right? It has here, through the upper two paths, it has two parallel connections, right? It can go through this first one, or the second one, or there is a third one. But the third one is not exactly a parallel connection because of the branching coming from here, right? So you have to consider this differently. But now let's see what you mentioned. So basically, we can reduce these two guys into one series connection and we eliminate node C. We no longer need node C, right? So let's do that step. So that step would make our network look like this: A, B, and D, E, and then the connections would look like this, and we will have one connection, another connection parallel to it, right? And this one is the 0.01 as it is. This is 0.01 as it is. This is 0.025, and this is 0.025 A, B, D, E, right? Sorry?
A, B is 25.
B, E, you mean, right? This one, 0.02. What's 25?
AB25,
okay. So now what remains is this one. What's gonna be the blocking probability of this one? Two in series. What's the blocking probability in that case? Probabilities. What's the probability that the link between B and D is blocked.
One.
How do you calculate that?
1 minus 0.05 times 1 minus 0.025.
Exactly. So it becomes 1 minus 0.05 times 1 minus 0.25. Right?
0.25.
Why? Why it's this way? Because the only way that the link between B and D is blocked, okay, you can think of it in two different ways. You can either drive it using the blocking probability, and in this case you would say it can happen in three ways. The first link is blocked. This is going to block the whole thing because it's a serious connection, right? And the second is not. Or the second link is blocked and the first is not. Or both are blocked, right? So these three cases will give you the blocking probability between B and D. The easier way is to say, because this is a serious connection, it's easier for me to think of it in terms of probability of not being blocked. So the probability of not being blocked is considered in only a single case, when both links are not blocked, right? So what's the probability that the first link is not blocked? 1 minus 0.05, right? What's the probability that the second link is not blocked? 1 minus 0.025. The probability both are not blocked is the multiplication. This will give you BD not blocked. But what you are looking for is BD blocked. So you have to take the complement. So that's why we subtract this multiplication from 1, which will give us blocking between B and D, right? Okay. Now we have these two in series, right? In parallel. So how can we reduce them further? Yeah, so we'll end up after that reduction with... Simply multiply it for parallel, yes.
Eh?
لو تبسط المسألة
يعني الحين اللي كتبته
قبل شوي ايوه
هذا ايه هذا كامل كامل كله
تمام
لو تبسط بيطلع 0.05 plus 0.025 0.05 ايوه minus 0.025 minus ضربهم الاثنين
لا ليه
لو
بسطت
كده
لو
بسطتها
ده يطلع كام؟ ها؟ الكالكوليشن بتاع ده يطلع كام؟
0.073
0.73 انا مش عارف انت عايزني اطلع ايه بس مش عارف.
لا الطريقة
اوكي اللي هي
يعني قلت 0.05 plus 0.025 minus ضرب
الاثنين. انت كنت هتكمل كده يعني؟ يس اتس كوريكت يس ذيس از ذا ثري ويز. ما هو ده الاذر واي ان انت تفكر فيهم على ثلاث طرق. الاولانية والثانية لا وبعدين الثانية والاولانية لا وبعدين الاثنين. اوكي. 0.05 ماشي انت فكيت ال اوكي اوكي يا يا اتس كوريكت وات يو ار سينج از كوريكت سو ان ذيس كيس اوكي A B is connected to E and B is connected to D with one link. What's gonna be the probability in that case? So we have this one become this whole thing becomes 0.073 مش كده 73 كفايه 737 ماشي 5 okay so and then you multiply this by 0.01 right because the parallel connection here for blocking it's the probability that both are blocked this is the only way a parallel connection is blocked right So this becomes 0.007375. Tamam? Now, what would you do in this case? We still need to tell me what. How will you do the same thing here?
But
where is a series or a parallel connection? Okay. Do it. Yes, I'm not disagreeing.
I don't remember the laws.
Okay. So what I will do? Okay. So what I will do, listen to me. What I will do is I'm going to leave this. This is 2B.
It's fine.
To be solved by each one and submitted on Thursday. Okay, and it will be bonus on quiz two.
Quiz two?
Quiz two, so please take a picture of this, or take a note of this, or draw it yourself, and put the numbers. And starting from here, I want you to get to a single probability of blocking between A and D.
This should be 0.30, not 20.
Yes, yes. 0.01.
0.000. Yes, 20.
Can we just neglect it and put 0 across?
Okay, no. Zero.
Okay, take a picture of this and simplify it and tell me what's going to be the total probability of blocking next time.
Hello? No. الحين
السؤال يا اخي الفول مارك الكويس لا لا ما جبتش انا سيره الفول مارك دي خالص
لا يعني في فرق بين اللي جايب 7 واللي
جايب
3 اي لا
تتفرج اصبر بس هنتكلم على الكويس في الاخر بس خلينا بس ايه في اللي احنا بنتكلم فيه دلوقتي اوكي. So this is one thing, please solve this and submit it on Thursday. It has to be submitted as hard copy here in class. Individual, you give it to me. خلاص? Here in class, hard copy. خلاص? Please tell the others. أنا هبعت announcement برضه على ال blackboard. Okay? So we'll leave this to next one and we can move on. Now the other part that we did not address yet and we'll start addressing it right now is how we can quantify traffic that goes through your network, okay? Now the unit for quantifying traffic is something called the Erlen, and that unit is eventually is a percentage or an efficiency unit. So eventually, the final unit that you use is going to be used to measure how much of the total capacity of the network is occupied by the offer traffic, right? And you can imagine that typically it should be less than 100%, but if it is greater than 100%, this means that the offer traffic is beyond the capacity of the network, and this means that the extra traffic is going to be blocked. It's not going to go through the network, right? And it's going to be dropped out, okay? So the network maximum can carry 100% of its capacity, cannot really carry anything beyond that. Now this guy, Erlen, he used to work as switching engineer. He's an electrical engineer, used to work as a switching engineer, so he worked in one of those you know, exchange offices, the offices where we call them now, nowadays he would call them the central office where telephone lines are aggregated, right? Yeah. At that time telephone was totally circuit switched analog system, right? At the time of this guy in the 1878 until 1929. Okay. Now, he came up with the method of calculating or quantifying the traffic such that you can use that eventually in planning and in monitoring the performance of his central office. Okay? So that's the idea of quantifying the traffic. So let's see how traffic is quantified. The first parameter that you look at in terms of quantifying traffic is something called the call holding time. It's the time on which a call is on, right? So if we are talking data network, this should be the time when the session is connected, until the session is ended, right? So the call holding time is the duration of the call. Now we are talking about random calls, right? So we cannot say that a call holding time is this number. It can be anything depending on the behavior of the caller, right, and the behavior of the network, right? So typically we use average call holding time. How do you get the average call holding time, and we call it H, capital H, right? You get that by adding all the call times, those ones that you see here, right, across all the different calls. So you do the summation of all TIs, right, and then you divide that by the number of calls, right? So each one of these lines, each one of those thick lines is a call duration, right? And then the second one is the duration of the second call. Third one is the duration of the third call, and so on, right? So you add these together, and then you divide them by the total number of calls, and this will give you an average of the time per call. So eventually, if you know that average, and you know that someone is initiating 10 calls, then the average holding time of that person is going to be the number of calls multiplied by the average call holding time, right? So that's what we mean by capital H for the call holding time. If you multiply the call holding time by the average number of calls per unit time, mu, which is called the average request rate per user, okay? Mu, the average call request rate per user, which is equal to the number of calls initiated from that user per a particular unit time. Whether you take that unit time as hour, you take it as minute, you take it as second, just make sure that you unify the time unit across all your calculations, okay? So if we multiply the average call holding time by the average call request rate per user, we get what's called the traffic intensity, right? Which is measured in Erlang. So traffic intensity is measured in Erlang, which is basically number of calls multiplied by number of calls per unit time multiplied by the call holding time, right? And this is a per user. If we have multiple users, then what you do is one of two things. Either you multiply by the number of users if all the users are doing the same thing, or if you have calculated this average age across all users, right? Otherwise, if different users have different average call holding times, then what you do here is the summation of the different call holding times of the different users, or basically not the call holding times, the summation of the offer traffic or the traffic intensity of the different users, right? And that is a measure of the overall system traffic, okay? Now notice that there are three parameters that plays into this game. There's a number of users, right? U, okay? There is the call duration or the call holding time, and we calculate an average for that, right? Actually, four parameters. So the number of users, U, the average call holding time or the call duration for each call, right? The average traffic request or call request rate per user, which is mu. And the last thing, which you don't see in this equation, but you will see it later on, okay, is how many channels are there in the system, right? So this system, which is shown here, represents a system with three channels, right? This is one channel, this is another channel, this is a third channel, okay? So why, what's the role of the channels? They allow multiple calls to go in parallel, right? So you can see that we have holding times that occur at the same time. This and this are occupying the same time, but they are in different channels. Those channels can be circuits, they can be different frequencies, they can be different codes, right? When you use spread spectrum, for example, and so on. So any parallel connections that can occur together, okay? So that's also an important factor, and we'll see when and how it plays a role in this system. So let's take an example on calculating the traffic offered to a particular system. This nice picture that you see over there represents a system of how many channels?
10
channels, right? And this system is measured or calculated over a time duration equal to 1 hour, 60 minutes, right? Okay. And then we see across each channel the holding time of the different calls that goes over that channel. So you see two numbers at the end of each channel, okay? The first number is the total amount of time that was occupied out of the 60 minutes, right? And the second number is number of calls. So this should be equal to the number of lines here, right? And this one should be equal to the summation of the line lengths, right, that you see in this graph, okay? So for the first channel, we have a total holding time of 51 minutes, right? And we have a total number of calls equal to 17. Second channel, we have a total of 47 minutes of holding time, and we have a total number of calls equal to 16 calls, and so on, right? If I want to calculate H, the average call holding time, what should I do?
Sum
all the holding times, right, which is summed here, and divide them by the total number of calls, right, which is also summed here. So simply, if you divide 294 over 97, you will get the H, the capital H, the average holding time per call. Notice that we have summed over all calls, regardless of the channels, right? So we have added all the calls together, okay? Okay. The second is, if I want to get the call rate per minute, the average call rate per minute, how can I do that?
How many calls I get over the hour?
Exactly.
Over the 1 hour, which is 60 minutes, right? So how many total calls I have, which is this number, divided by how many minutes I have for those calls, right? So all these calls arrived within 60 minutes, right? So the total number of calls divided by the total time duration will give me the average call arrival rate or the average call request rate, right? Mu. So now I have mu and I have H. Can I calculate the total offer traffic to this system? Yes. What's going to be the total offer traffic?
Mu
times H, which is going to be equal to 4.9 Erlang. Okay? Now the question is, I told you that the measure of the traffic is relative to the network, right? Right now, we just measured the offer traffic. How do I know, how does this measure as compared to the network itself? What should I do?
Divide by number of channels.
Divide by?
Number of channels.
Why?
That's the capacity that can handle.
Correct. Everyone agrees? So this number that we see here, if I think of it, what does it represent actually?
Exactly.
It represents as if I have added all these together, normal lines though, and then tried to spread them across the channel, and I will see that if I concatenate all of them, they will occupy four channel and 0.9 of the fifth channel, right? And then the remaining part is going to be? No? Why no?
I didn't get it.
Oh, you didn't get it? It's different from no. Okay.
No, I said.
Okay. So you didn't get what exactly?
Specific channel, like why would it?
Specific? Huh.
Because you were trying to calculate the number of calls.
I was just saying, if we look at this number, A, that we calculated here, which sums up to 4.9, how it was calculated will show you, if you look at how it was calculated, it will show you that what we did basically is add or attach these lines together, those call duration, across all the channels, right? And then take them and try to spread them over the full channel duration, which is 60 minutes, right? And you will find that if you spread them, they will occupy four parallel lines and 0.9 of the fifth one, right? Okay? Now, this is how much you occupied out of your 10 available channels, right? So basically, if you want to get the utilization of this system in Erlangs per channel, you will find that the utilization is going to be equal to 4.9 divided by 10, which is going to be that on the average, each channel is 49% utilized. Okay?
Yes.
Everyone got the idea?
Okay, good.
So here is another example that does the same thing. It says that, assume that a channel is occupied 30 minutes during an hour. A channel which is occupied 30 minutes during an hour carries on the average 0.5 Erlangs, right? Okay. And one channel completely occupied at all times carries one Erlang, and a trunk with 30 lines can carry at most 30 Erlangs, right? So this just the meanings, right? And now look at the example in a telephone network. In a telephone network, if the average holding time per call in a network is 3 minutes, and the average call request is 4 calls per hour, per user, right? Then the traffic intensity per user is going to be equal to?
We have to make
So the first part, about 3 minutes, this is equal to capital H, right? And the second one, which is 4 calls per hour per user, is equal to mu. So the offer traffic is equal to mu times H, right? So you just need to multiply the 4 times the 3. But why do you divide by 60? Because you have to use, exactly, because you have to use the same units, right? And we are talking about measuring time in minutes. So I have to divide, to convert everything to minutes. That's why we divide it by. So if it's 4 calls per hour, we must get how many calls per minute we have, right? And then the result is going to be 0.2 Erlang per user. So far we are doing it per user, right? Now assume that this system has 3,000 users and they are symmetric users, then the total offer traffic is going to be 3,000 times the Erlang per user, which is going to be equal to 3,000 times 0.2, which is equal to 600 Erlang. If this system has 800 channels, the capacity of the system is 800 channels, then the overall Erlang of the system, right, per channel is going to be 600 divided by 800, which is equal to 0.75, which means that on the average, if the load is equally distributed across all channels, each channel is going to be 75% utilized, right, and the remaining 25% is going to be idle or not used. Alas? Clear? This is how we do the traffic calculations. Any questions about this? Okay, so I'm going to stop at this point and I'm going to discuss with you quickly what we will do with the quiz.
So when I noticed the answer,
I was actually, I couldn't do it. I tried to do it, but it was, I think, yeah, you said 10 minutes to the end, you were out, so.
No, I said 2 minutes
to the end. Oh, yeah, so even I was out then.
Okay, so when I looked at the answers, now what happened right now is that the system automatically corrected what's there, right? And when I looked at the answers, I found 2 common mistakes that they are not really conceptual mistakes, so I can overcome them, but in a fair way. So one mistake was that many of you, when they calculated the percentage or the utilization, even though I specified leave it as decimal number, but some of you, because of doing it quickly and time crunch and so on, you converted it to percentage. So instead of 0.97, it became 97, right? For that one, I'm going to manually go across all the questions, and if you did it that way, instead of getting a 0, you'll get the full mark. So it's going to be similar to those who solved it with percentage, okay? Now the second common mistake is that in the second question, many of you, when I asked for the flag length, they actually gave me k, the number of ones, right? And instead of going for k plus 2, which is the flag length, right? So what I will do in this case, but I cannot give you the full mark, I will need to be fair. Those who give me K, they will take 2 out of 3. Those who give me the correct flag length, they will take 3 out of 3. So whoever wrote, for example, if the flag length was 14, whoever wrote 14 will take the full mark. Whoever wrote 12 will take 2 out of 3. Fair enough? Okay. Next time, read the questions and figure out what you need to put in the answer. Okay. So in addition to this, you have the chance of also using your bonus. So I hope that we can skip over quiz 2. I'm not sure what's happening in quiz 2. It keeps on getting stuck, but I hope we don't need to go back to quiz 2. Okay. And don't forget, today is the deadline for your assignment. If you have any questions, we still have about 3 minutes. So you can ask me a question now. And the other thing is, the quiz on this assignment, the solution is going to be out as soon as the deadline passes, and the quiz on this assignment is going to be on Thursday. So this coming Thursday, inshallah, we'll have a quiz on assignment 3. And you will have assignment 4 posted.
No,
doctor, about...
Just stop recording.